Good morning and welcome everyone to the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee's sixth meeting of 2021. For our first item today, we'll conclude taking evidence on the updated climate change plan with evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform, Dana Cunningham. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and welcome to your officials. Our officials joining the Cabinet Secretary, Helena Gray, Deputy Director of Climate Change Domestic Division, Sasha Maguire, Senior Economic Advisor, Alison Irvin, Director of Transport Strategy and Analysis, Neil Rafferty, Head of Electricity Policy and Large Scale Renewables, Ragna Lowe, the Head of Heat Planning, and John Kerr, Head of Agriculture Policy Division, all from the Scottish Government. Cabinet Secretary, and it's fair to say that the targets in the Climate Change Act are extremely challenging, and the government did press those targets to be even more challenging than originally set out. Now, of course, the updated climate change plan has to provide a pathway for meeting those challenging targets. Can I ask you how confident you are that the plan will hit them?
I'm pretty confident. I think we said from the outset that, you know, we couldn't produce anything that, you know, would give you a mathematical certainty. Obviously, the plan's been drafted against an extraordinary set of circumstances, and has been done at haste. It's an update to an actual plan. I believe that given that the CCC recommendation originally was for 70% by 2030, and that particular target was considered by them to be just about feasible, they felt they'd, in a sense, recommended the most stretching target. And given that the Parliament then effectively unanimously decided to go further than that, right from the start, we've probably been in somewhat uncharted territory. And none of this is new to the committee, of course, because we've discussed this before. We are, however, confident that this package does present a credible pathway to the envelopes, bearing in mind all of the significant uncertainties there are. There's limits to devolution, there's technological advancement, which without a crystal ball we can never be certain about. There's just transition, fuel poverty, and indeed there are still scientific uncertainties in the measuring of emissions. So we do believe what is in front of you provides a strong foundation, sets a pathway towards 2032, because of course the climate change plan goes out to 2032. And contributes to net zero by 2045. And it's also a very strong signal of intent, which I think is incredibly important, because the signals that government gives are equally as important in terms of delivering the rapid decarbonisation that that we require. So I am as confident as I can be that this actually does put us on the right road. Can I be 100% mathematically certain that it will? No, but I suppose in truth one can never be, and even had we embarked on doing a full climate change plan, even a full climate change plan can never deliver that kind of certainty, as we've seen with our own plans.
Thank you. And there obviously will be certain policy areas that have been based on emissions calculations, and there'll be others that aren't. Can I ask you just to take me through the ones that have been based on emissions calculations, and for the ones that haven't, what assumptions have been made about the reductions there?
Well, I'm not quite sure what you mean. I mean, for example, the one that we have talked about a lot is peatland. And that has been made on, insofar as we are able scientifically at the moment, that has been based very much on emissions calculations. We had to deal with what was going to be a change in those calculations that was coming anyway, and that's been part and parcel of what we've tried to do. So that's been really important. We do know the the calculations around waste. So there is probably a little bit more clarity around that. We also know around forestry, so I'm using the examples from my own portfolio, obviously. Well, forestry is not my portfolio, but it does cross over a bit. So these are if you will, these are some of the ones that are most clearly identifiable in terms of being able to calculate the emissions outcomes. Others perhaps are a bit less certain. We can say with some certainty when we talk about transport emissions, what can and cannot be achieved in terms of emissions reductions with certain actions. We're then slightly less certain in terms of whether or not some of it might come forward. So, you know, we have hydrogen fuel buses, and I know that you will be aware of those because they're in Aberdeen. But it's the extent to which that might then become a thing, if you like, as to whether or not we get greater or not such great emissions reductions through that. I mean, I you know, I think it's a mix in just about every area of endeavour, because, for example, going back to peatland, that is very highly subject to continued scientific work, which may yet again change the emissions reductions figures. So even in those areas where we feel that at this point in time we can calculate, there is no guarantee because the science changes. And that is one of the realities that we are all dealing with.
I'm going to bring in Liz Smith, who has a couple of questions on this area. Liz?
Thank you and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. May I dig a little bit deeper on the 2030 carbon reduction target? Just in the comments that Chris Stark made, where he agreed with that target, as of course the Parliament did too, but he did say the delivery of that was on, and I quote, the fringes of credibility. And in your letter, your correspondence to the committee, you have quite rightly pointed out that part of this problem is about the pace of technological change. Could you just tell us a little bit more about where you have concerns on that pace, on what you're doing to monitor the pace of technological change, because it's obviously crucial?
Absolutely, but I just want to pick up a little bit on the Chris Stark stuff, because you know, I said at the outset that the CCC recommendation, the Committee on Climate Change recommendation, our statutory advisers recommended 70% by 2030. So we chose to go beyond that to 75%. It would have been remarkable if Chris Stark had come to the committee and said, oh, well, now you mention it, actually 75% is OK, we were wrong. So, you know, I think his comments would have been absolutely predictable, because in their view, 70% was at the outside of what we could achieve. Now, we've chosen to go further than that. But I'm not entirely sure that I would get terribly stressed by Chris Stark's comments in those circumstances. I would say that it was highly likely that he would say something like that. In terms of the science or the technological change, because the two things go together. You know, I've talked about the science of measuring emissions, but the technological change is also important. I mean, there are all sorts of areas where there are significant uncertainties, and it's not something that I'm qualified to make a huge judgment call on. So we don't have all the answers now. That is true. There is reliance on carbon capture and storage. I may say that was strongly recommended by the CCC as being part of what we should be including. So we haven't departed from the CCC advice on that. They were quite strongly of view of that. But we all of us know that is dependent on that being brought forward as a usable technology that will help us in this regard. And I know my colleague Paul Wheelhouse works very hard in his portfolio to try and ensure that we are making moves there. So there's one area where perhaps it's not the fact of it that is the issue, it's the potential speed with which it can be done. But I believe that we are, and you know, although it's not my portfolio area directly, I have on occasions had conversations, obviously, about it, that a lot of work is taking place. And we do, of course, have the capacity to move forward, as we did some years ago, when unfortunately the advances that were being made in carbon capture and storage at that time weren't proceeded with. So it's a combination of the two things. So there's the science, both in terms of research as well as technology, but there's also the willingness to commit to that. And the commitment, I think, is what is important, because that's what's giving the signal.
Yeah. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I don't doubt the commitment at all. You do say in your correspondence with the committee, though, that you are monitoring this situation. And obviously, you've just pointed out that it does cross several portfolios. Can I just ask, though, what is the Scottish Government doing to monitor where there might be serious issues within technological advance, which, as I say, are so crucial to delivering some of the changes and targets that we want to see?
I'm not incredibly sure what you're asking me there. I mean, you know, we are, as much as possible, ourselves staying across the research that is done, where it is done, and looking for the opportunities where we think that Scotland would be able to benefit from them. I mean, there are potential technological changes out there, and I'm not a scientist, so I don't mind. There are potential technological changes out there that might not be particularly attractive to Scotland for its own particular geography, geology, and urban-rural kind of mix. So each country will be looking carefully at technology in the future to see what works best for them. But it is important that we, I think, continually watch that. And I, you know, there are areas of and I can't speak for every portfolio here, but I know, for example, that I get fed through to me notable research in various areas, either about emissions measurements or about some of the technologies that might work in my portfolio areas. I can, I presume that that is the same case that is happening everywhere, portfolio by portfolio.
Yeah, what I'm trying to drive at, Cabinet Secretary, is the fact that obviously we spent a lot of time asking witnesses who've come before the committee, including your own Scottish Government officials, asking where we can spot that there are concerns and problems about the pace of development, and therefore, you know, that is vitally important in terms of making the policy.
Pace of development is slightly different, I think, because that's subject to not just technological change, but is also subject to, in many cases, commitment to that potential change.
Just looking at it overall, Cabinet Secretary, obviously, there has been very considerable progress in Scotland on some areas, and credit to the Scottish Government for that. But there are other areas where things have not been going quite so well. And that's why, as a committee, we have to investigate exactly where the problems are. And what I'm trying to get at is, what do we have to do to ensure that we are keeping up with the pace that is required in the difficult areas, to ensure that we can meet some of the targets more quickly.
Right, okay. So it would be helpful, I suppose, if we could talk about some specific areas, because actually, technologically, some of the biggest potential changes will be taking place in the sector in which Scotland has already been recognised as making enormous improvements. So the energy sector is a sector where some of the biggest technological changes may take place, and yet that's the sector that has already in Scotland been subject to far greater decarbonisation than many other countries, and indeed typically when Scotland is anywhere, represented anywhere, they'll want to drag you onto an energy discussion stage because of that. So ironically, it's the one area where there are a lot of uncertainties potentially around the technological capacity, but it's in that one area where Scotland is already ahead. I'm trying to think of other areas where we might still be waiting on some technologies to change. I suppose there is still a bit of uncertainty around, technologically speaking, where the transport emissions might best be affected. You know, is it going to be hydrogen? Is it going to be electric vehicles? Or indeed, is it going to be fewer vehicles overall, i.e., you know, all of the private car owners will have to rethink their own, you know. So there are things that are technologically at this point doable, but the question is whether or not in terms of mass rollout they will have the impacts that you might want. So you know, the hydrogen buses in Aberdeen, are we going to see hydrogen buses everywhere, or will a different approach be taken? That's, I guess, a bit more uncertain.
Okay, I'll just finish on the point that I think, you know, there has been excellent progress in some things like hydrogen and the basis for the scope for jobs in that area in the future. But there are sectors that are struggling more in terms of the pace of change, like agriculture, for example, and like transport. So it was okay. Just trying to drill down on where the Scottish Government is.
And I think that's a fair enough point to be making. I mean, it is the case that some sectors like energy have made enormous inroads, but to a certain extent, some of that I think is always likely to happen because we do take a whole economy approach to this. You know, we set the targets right across the economy, and we do set emissions envelopes, obviously, that have indicators for each sector, but we don't expect that, for example, agriculture could deliver the same emissions reductions changes that energy has. By definition, agriculture is food production, and food production will always mean emissions. So the question there is getting emissions managed down as far as possible. And agriculture has made inroads in that. There's more to do. Obviously, there is more to do. You know, working that through the whole of the economy is what's really important. So I don't know if there are other. I mean, I'm presuming the committee is going to want to talk more about agriculture anyway. But I mean, it's for us, it's really just trying to. And so, you know, there are quite a lot of things which are demand sensitive, so that you know, some of the emissions reductions will come about because of a shift in demand rather than technological change. And that's a little bit harder, as we all know, to basically put a figure on.
Okay, thank you.
I'm going to go to Finlay Carson on agriculture, but Claudia Beamish has asked a quick supplementary on Liz Smith's questions there. Claudia.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to you, Cabinet Secretary, and to those who are accompanying you today. Could I ask whether the Scottish Government has been able to calculate the emissions effect of their capital investment programme in the context of the updated plan? And if so, for how far is it up until 2032? And as I appreciate this could change, but we have had the Commission. And I'm wondering that this has been or will be calculated.
The whole capital investment programme?
Yes.
Or the low carbon investment?
What the effect of the whole programme will be on our emissions, high, medium and low, whether that's been assessed. I've seen, of course, the assessment of high, medium and low, but all put together is the question, whether it has been or if it's possible to assess that.
I'm not sure we've done it for the entire carbon programme quite in the way that you're asking. You know, we kind of look at what we've got and some of the decisions that are made, that is, it's not the only decision, it's not the only factor in it, but it is an important factor. We do try, as you know, as part of the and I guess some of that will come up in the budget discussion later. We do try as far as possible to ensure that we do work that out. But in the way that you're asking, I'm not sure what it is you're looking for. Are you looking for, because I said at the outset, we don't have an absolute mathematical calculation for a lot of this. So it's important to understand that. And in some cases, that won't be certain.
Right. In terms of time, I'll leave it at that, perhaps for this, and we'll highlight that to you in more detail in writing. Thank you.
Thank you, Claudia. Can I go to Finlay Carson?
Thank you, convener. Just before I go into the section I want to focus on in the balance of effort, you know, we've already heard, and I know you've addressed it, that Chris Stark suggested we're on the fringe of credibility, and I know you're very passionate about Pete. And that's
you don't want me to talk about that.
We've got these passions in life, and Pete, I'm not going to say it's a bad thing, but at the moment, you know, we've got ambitious targets for 20,000 hectares of peat restoration. At the moment, we're only about 6,000. You know, I know the Parliament voted to have reductions of 75% by 2030, whatever, and they are ambitious. But is the government at risk of using unquantifiable carbon capture and just adding more and more and more peat into the equation from a desktop exercise just to balance the books to make it look like we can get it, when actually net zero by 2045 is actually unrealistic? Do we need to be honest? Do the government need to be honest and say, look, we're putting figures in here to balance the books, but actually we don't think it's going to be achievable by 2045?
Well, that's an interesting theory. I don't know whether or not you challenged Chris Stark on its achievability by 2045, since after all it was the CCC recommendation that we adopt a net zero target by 2045. The answer to you, the first part of your question about peat, and yes, I am passionate about it, but you're right to point to up until now, the slow uptake on that. I think that you know, that effectively was the reason why we put the huge investment in that we announced earlier this year, because I am conscious that there are very many barriers to peatland being restored, barriers that are the kinds of barriers, if you can remove them, it will allow work to be done to scale. And working to scale in this particular area is going to be incredibly important. So, you know, multi-year commitment is massively important. Consistency, companies knowing that they are going to be able to draw down that, decisions that can be made, a bit like the flood management system, where we understand that you don't, you know, design, plan and build a flood management system all within 1 year. It has to be spread. So the same with peatland restoration. So our view was that commitment was unlocking the potential. Now, yes, you're right, it is a form of carbon capture, but it isn't, I guess, what most people are thinking of as carbon capture. The carbon capture that we mostly end up talking about is technology that comes out of the fossil fuel side of the problem, rather than the carbon capture that exists in the wood of trees and in the healthy or restored peatlands. So I suppose in my head, I don't think of it so much as carbon capture. as actually delivering something beyond that, because of course it delivers a lot of other benefits as well. It was very much specifically with a view to effecting a massive step change in that slow restoration programme by making it financially something which would actually work. And I am in the process of having conversations with the sector to talk through with them the speed with which they will be able to move. So it is a very active thing in terms of government at the moment, as you might guess it might be, given my absolute commitment to it.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that. I'm now going to move on to other line of questioning. In oral evidence to the committee, there was lots of suggestions that there's likely to be job losses in some industries, regardless of whether there's a just transition or not. And the pace of change was really important. So in particular, in the agricultural sector, some witnesses have suggested that it wasn't clear why agriculture was protected. I'm not sure protected is the word that I would like to use, because I think agriculture is doing their bit. Why is it that the Scottish Government, and what evidence did the Scottish Government decide not to attribute additional abatement efforts to agriculture? And by shielding, if you like, agriculture in the short term, or not moving as quickly in the short term, is there the chance that in the future it may be hit harder?
Well, I'm afraid I can't really speak to the future. It would be great if I could. I think that there's one or two things that I do need to respond to in that. The decisions about the decarbonisation pathway for agriculture were based on a science that was available to us, an assessment of technically feasible measures, which basically comes out of research undertaken by Climate Exchange and the SRUC. So, you know, we used work that was there to try and inform what we thought the decarbonisation pathway for agriculture should be. If you try to reduce emissions more quickly, then the danger is that you harm domestic production, and you do risk damage right across the sector. And as Finlay Carson is probably well aware, that would probably have a disproportionately larger impact in remote and rural areas and vulnerable areas. And there's also another danger that if we don't also change domestic demand, or if domestic demand isn't impacted, then reducing production for Scottish agriculture would just be replacing it with like-for-like imports and the associated emissions from places that don't farm as sustainably as we are trying to get to. So there's quite a lot to talk about in terms of agriculture. And there are, as Finlay Carson may be aware, farmer-led groups, we're making a lot of progress with them. So the farmers themselves get into the driving seat of what might be considered most important. So the Beef Suckler Climate Group is making good progress, and there are further farmer-led groups on arable, dairy and hill, upland and crofting, to look at what those key sectors can do, and they will each be able to do different things. They'll help us in how to deliver some of the key policies in the plan update, but they themselves, of course, might come forward with other things that will be useful and helpful for the future. I think it's a balance here between managing what the science tells us is from our perspective, the sensible decarbonisation pathway for agriculture, and what there might be available to us in the future. And that's not a question that I can answer today.
Finlay, have we got you back? Are you there, Finlay?
Yes, I beg your pardon. I'm sorry, Cabinet Secretary. I lost all of that, but I'll not ask you to repeat it. You'll be pleased to hear.
Okay, the key takeaway, if you didn't hear it, was that research was undertaken by the Climate Exchange and the SRUC, and informed by their research, and it was based on an assessment of technically feasible measures available. That's specifically what we based this on. So it wasn't just a figure plucked out of the air, if that was concerning you.
Okay. Thank you for that. What I'm going to do now, because my connection's a bit dodgy, I'll ask you two questions in one go, and hopefully, if I drop out the committee, we'll get your answers. How frustrated are you? You've talked about the other farmer groups, and there's the suckler cow and the beef production groups and whatever, but there was an accusation laid from some of the witnesses that there were so many different groups that there was a potential for a mishmash of policies, and we really weren't moving forward quick enough. And Chris Stark also said he was disappointed we didn't have a firm policy going forward. And, you know, just in the last few days, we've heard that the agri-environment budget has been cut. Are you frustrated we're not getting some clear policies going forward, which will help address some of the uncertainties when it comes to carbon capture and the agricultural sector? And my final question is, that given carbon management for agriculture and LULUCF are expected to come closer together, what justification is there still for these to be considered as separate sectors and distinct when ultimately land use, agriculture, forestry, peat, they're all integrated in some extent?
I'll answer the last question first. That is how the greenhouse gas inventory is designed. Notwithstanding the clear synergies between the two sectors, it isn't in our gift to effectively put them together in the way that you're talking about, because we have to be able to measure them separately in terms of the greenhouse gas inventory. And unless that changes, some of this will still be baked in. The first part of the question about frustration about no clear policies, well, you know, one could almost say that just about every single sector and not just agriculture. I think the upside to the farmer-led groups is that you will actually get, because, you know, as we learn, that there is never a one-size-fits-all approach. And while people think agriculture is all the same thing, it's not all the same thing. And you know, one size fits all isn't going to work there. So the point about the farmer-led groups is actually for us to be able to get to much more quickly the things that will actually work in those areas that are separated out. I mean, one size fits all. What works for a farmer with a highly productive farm in, for example, rural Perthshire, is not going to work for a crofter in the Western Isles. So you've got to do this. The notion that it is slowing anything down, I think, is mistaken, because my suspicion is it will actually deliver more in the long run, because we will get to solutions much more quickly for those specific sectors. I think that's really, really important for agriculture as a whole. After all, agriculture isn't just a word on a bit of paper. It is about food production. And that's a pretty fundamental requirement anywhere in the world.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. Mark wanted to ask a very brief supplementary on this, then Mark, we will need to move on. So please make it brief. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, convener. Looking at the plan, I see lots of initiatives to try and make things more efficient, but I don't see a big shift. I don't see a big shift in the shape of farming and agriculture in 2030. I don't see any recommendations in relation to diet as well. Why is that? Is the government just sort of not really wanting to rock the boat, not wanting to annoy particular sectors or to describe a pathway which could result in people shifting into different forms of production? Is it very much about keeping the existing shape of Scottish agriculture and dietary choice, but just making it that wee bit more efficient for 2030?
Well, the next Parliament is going to have to do a brand new climate change plan. This is not a climate change plan in that sense. This was a fast, forced update to an existing climate change plan. I have to say that from perspective of the work that we've been able to do over the last year, the notion that we were going to introduce some kind of revolutionary change in any sector, or at least map a pathway to that, to designing a revolutionary change in any sector, would always have been an unrealistic expectation. We're updating an existing climate change plan. And I need to remind committee members of that. That was what was agreed. And some of this was in generality discussed at the time we were thinking about what this might look like and the different forms it might take. So it's not a complete climate change plan. Perhaps the next climate change plan will think about that. I didn't think trying to undertake an assessment of that form of huge shift that you're talking about would have been manageable within the timescale within which we were operating. And what we have done is to try and bring forward what we consider to be feasible. And I've flagged up the climate exchange and SRUC work that people are obviously able to go and see themselves, to see that was the basis on which we were looking at what we were delivering in terms of the update. The issue of dietary change isn't really so much about agricultural production, although I understand why it tends to come up in this context, but it is really more an issue of consumer behaviour and public health, and therefore needs a wider conversation. Just producing, and I'm presuming this is about meat and dairy, just reducing production of this in Scotland doesn't actually mean that the public will eat less of it. It just means that it will source what it gets from elsewhere. And we risk an impact on farmers, crofters, and all along the supply chain without actually delivering anything that we might want to do in terms of public health, or reducing emissions, and I think that is going to have to be handled in a slightly different way with rather different messages than you could have done in terms of the update that we've been able to produce for this year. Now, you know, reducing consumer demand involves a very different set of public engagement to the one that we're talking about here in terms of the climate change update. And it is certainly, from my portfolio perspective, one that would involve at least one other major portfolio, the health portfolio, who are right at this moment somewhat preoccupied, understandably, elsewhere.
Thank you. Can I go to Stuart Stevenson? Hopefully Stuart is still with us. I know you've had connection problems this morning, Stuart, so I'll hand over to you and cross my fingers.
Thank you. It looks to me as if it's working okay, although I have departed twice so far. I just want to, Cabinet Secretary, fairly concisely to just tackle how we're dealing with the addition of peat to the international inventory of climate emissions. And I'm just making a numerical point. It happens to be about peat. Now, obviously, we've always wanted peat to be in the inventory because we felt it was an important contributor, but it's not been there. The addition of peat has, of course, raised the amount of emissions in the inventory in 1990 and therefore changed the baseline. Therefore added to the emissions before in the way that we have. But clearly, as we're doing a lot on peat, has it correspondingly, in terms of the international inventory, also created the opportunity for us to make an even bigger contribution to the inventory than had been the case before the change in the baseline that's been caused by the addition of peat. In other words, although it's bad news in one way, is the addition of peat really good news for the way that our actions on peat will manage the numbers? Yes, I know, I'm being a mathematician. Sorry, Cabinet Secretary.
I suppose the short answer is yes. I remember when we were embarking on the climate change legislation, our big panic at that time was how we would manage the prospective massive increase in peatland emissions, which wasn't an actual increase in peatland emissions, but was a different measurement, and it was scaling it back to 1990 and the impact that was going to have. And we were very concerned about the coming forward with a way to handle it, which showed the difference between, you know, the two bits of effort. The 1990 to present day effort had this not been the case, and then sitting beside that, a calculation about the additional problem that it did develop. But on the other hand, you're absolutely right, because the capacity then in Scotland particularly, and let's not forget, this is not just about our targets, it's also about the UK's targets as a whole, the capacity of Scotland to contribute massively to that is very much higher because of the scientific measurement. My slight fear is that the scientists will keep remeasuring this, and that we will be constantly dealing with moving goalposts. To a certain extent, I rest at the moment on the £250 million commitment that's been made to effect a step change in peatland restoration. And there's a lot to unpack in that, because it does mean that some of the issues around peatland restoration have to be relooked at, not just about the scale of it, but even the where of it is very important. But yeah, it does then give you an opportunity to achieve massive changes, both in terms of our emissions reductions, but in terms of the UK's emissions reductions as a whole. In fact, if I recall correctly, and forgive me, I don't have the reference, the CCC did naughtily, and I mean naughty, they were naughty in suggesting that perhaps such was the potential impact of work done on peatland in Scotland, that the UK government itself ought to be thinking about either subsidising some of that or directly investing themselves in it, because it was going to be such a game changer all round if we get it right. Haven't yet seen that happening, but who knows?
Thank you. Can I come to Mark Roskell? Mark.
Yeah, thanks, convener. I wanted to ask about the trajectory of emissions, particularly buildings, transport, waste. They do seem to plateau. I don't know if this is down to the Times model, but they do seem to plateau halfway through the climate change plan update. And I think, you know, there is a question about how do we maintain that momentum beyond 2032? So I wanted to ask about how those decisions around that profiling was made, and what kind of assumptions and judgments were taken into account, and how that then links into the 2045, the much longer term target. I'm aware, for example, there's a discussion going on with the Heat Networks Bill at the moment about setting targets beyond 2030. So how do we keep momentum, and what kind of thinking was factored into this update, and how that pushes the momentum towards net zero?
Well, obviously the climate change plan update was to take into account the decision that the Parliament made for the period up to the target date of 2030, keeping in mind the 2045 target, but you know, we're focusing very much on the 2030 target. There is a kind of lumpiness across the sectors. But it does, the sector emissions profiles do reflect the balance of effort across the sectors. There's a kind of lumpy introduction of some technologies, which is what I guess we're a little bit uncertain about. You know, and there's a kind of, we're trying to prevent envelopes going down then up as a result of the carbon capture storage coming on stream 2930. You know, some of this is quite difficult. We have statutory targets for each year, but the emissions envelopes are not statutory targets. They're guides. They're not targets. They're just trying to keep us on the right track. There are, you know, there is sometimes modelling, but it's just one tool in the box. And I think we've already discussed earlier in the committee that times, we couldn't just apply times to this all the way through. So, you know, we're trying to reflect the balance of effort across the sectors. There is some flatness on emissions and what we're trying to do is look over that slightly longer term rather than just year to year because of the lumpiness of the technological change perspective.
But is that plateauing though? Is that thought through? Is that just something that's come out of the times modelling, or is that because there are specific reasons why the emissions abatement effort slows down at that point? I'm just trying to work out whether we take this with a pinch of salt or not. It's just an aberration, or it's actually, no, that is the reality. Things will slow down because of X. It's really difficult to get that.
Well, because these things are difficult. I mean, you know, there's no point trying to persuade people that this is a simple exercise. It's not a simple exercise. There's a degree of judgment has to be brought into all of the decisions that we're making. Our assessment is that you know, we will make some serious and rapid progress early, and then there's a pointer towards the later stages in the development of other technologies, which suggests to us that the likelihood is that there might be a bit of slowing up in the middle. Now, you know, we've tried to focus on what will deliver earliest, fastest, which is what effectively the CCC's recommendation was, that we would try and do that. And of course, by doing that, it does lead, you know, for that then to get to a point where a lot of that has been rolled out. We've got a slight pause then to rethink, because, you know, we've got a whole climate change plan to do in the next parliament. So there is potentially massive rethinking taking place then. And that, of course, climate change plan will focus far more on the long run than the climate change plan update has been able to do. But we were deliberately, I mean, we were asked by the CCC to do this, to focus on fast and early delivery, and that's effectively what we have tried to do. So that does lead to that slight kind of sense of from now till 2030 being a game of two halves.
Thanks.
Mark, can I hand over to Claudia, who has some questions around just transition and behaviour change? Claudia.
Thank you, Convener. And could I ask you, Cabinet Secretary, how the principles and process have been assessed? And it would be interesting to know how that's happened and to see evidence of that in the climate change plan. And also, do you think that there's a risk that if just transition is not affordable to everyone, that it sort of undermines it? So how could the Scottish Government try to ensure, and I stress the word try to ensure, that that low carbon goods and services are available to everyone, that the wealthy take their fair share of the emissions?
Well, the first to the first point, I just need to, and I know we're all tend towards just simplifying our language, but this is not a climate change plan. This is an update to a plan. This is not and never could have been an encyclopedic version of a plan by any other name. So I just need to just say that, because we slide into misleading ourselves if we're not careful about what this is. I mean, obviously, Just Transition is our focus on Just Transition has become much greater over the last few years. And I think it's fair to say that in comparison to when the original climate change legislation was passed. We are in constant contact with the Just Transition Commission in terms of getting their advice and guidance about what we do and how we do it. Does actually inform an enormous number of the more specific decisions that are then made. And I think that's really important to say, that even at a much more granular level than might be talked about here, the thinking is about the impact in that sense. So the whole issue around heat and buildings cannot simply be about the measurement of emissions reductions. It's also got to be about how you guard against exacerbating fuel poverty at the same time. So that in a sense is baked in now to just about everything we do. And I think it's important for us to say that even with peatland transition, one of the big benefits is about jobs. And jobs are important in terms of this whole Just Transition. Now, I think, Claudia, you went on to talk about the question of affordability. So there are aspects to Just Transition that are different. So jobs is one big aspect of Just Transition, because earlier referred to job losses. There are always industries that kind of go out of use, and I hope I'm not insulting you, Claudia, to say that, you know, there are those of us of an older generation that can remember job titles and work that simply doesn't exist anymore because the world has changed. So that always happens. So it's not about job losses per se, it's about the ability to actually transition across into different job markets. But the affordability issue is also a key part of this. It's not just about jobs, it's about the affordability. So it's quite tricky, but we do know we're not going to achieve a just transition if the opportunities and the affordability isn't something that is distributed fairly. And I think we've had a pretty abrupt lesson this last year in how embedded that unfairness, that inequality can be and is. So what we've tried to do in the coordinated approach set out in the plan does demonstrate how those principles are being embedded across government policy. And I've given you an example of that already. I want to reassure members of the committee that each of the, when different portfolios are now looking at these different policy issues, they do have these things in mind. It is very much to the forefront of how we are thinking. We do listen to the Just Transition Commission advice. You know, they advised us to think more about bus travel, effectively we've put in £500 million investment into bus travel. So you're effectively doing that support means that you are supporting the particular transport public transport mode that is most used by people on low incomes, providing greater accessibility. Now, right now, a discussion about public transport is a completely different discussion than we would have had up until about March last year, and is a completely different discussion about public transport than I hope we are able to have once this pandemic goes past. We are in a profoundly difficult scenario at the moment. But I just want to reassure everybody that these issues are being thought about in every portfolio. I'm involved in some of those conversations, but I won't be involved in every single one of those conversations for obvious reasons.
Claudia, can I bring in Liz Smith, who's got a question on your chain?
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, one of the key issues for the next Parliament will be a political decision about policy making and whether we have to be more punitive in our actions to encourage and force behavioural change. And you mentioned this in your first answer to me, actually, about changes in demand. And tomorrow, I think it is, we're looking at changes to plastic bag pricing, etc. Do you think that the next Parliament will have to be more punitive in policy making in terms of trying to achieve the targets?
So I wouldn't use the word punitive. I think that that's already casting it in a very negative way. I think there are obvious
witnesses have said.
Well, maybe. I think we have to continue as much as possible to take people with us. If I may say, that does put certain sectors of society into a leadership role, and one of those is politicians. I would very much hope that when some of the discussions are happening, that we don't see people just taking an easy way out of the conversation. And I've said in the past that willing the ends, voting for 75% by 2030, willing that end is of no use whatsoever unless we can will the means. And sometimes the means may be difficult conversations. And demand management is perhaps one of those difficult conversations that we'll have to be grappled with. But I do think it is going to be a case of carrots and sticks. And it isn't, the demand management just doesn't have to be about, we will tell you what you're going to do. But the demand management has to be about removing some of the obstacles to doing the right thing in the first place. People are not necessarily always deliberately doing the wrong thing out of spite. They're often forced into it because they don't have much in the way of alternative. And those are all things that are going to have to be grappled with by all governments everywhere in the world. There are some really tricky conversations to be had, and I think it is only right that they be had. But people have to, and by people I mean us, politicians, do have to think about what that means. Because if it's us just telling them what to do, but we're not going to bother doing it ourselves, then that's going to get everybody absolutely nowhere.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Can I come to Mark Ruskell, please?
Yeah, thanks. I wonder if I could just ask a brief supplementary on the back of that. Chris Stark said that some of these sort of punitive measures might include scrappage schemes. Do you see that as an area that we need to go? I'm not quite clear how controversial a scrappage scheme for boilers, for example, would be. Should we be making more high carbon assets redundant and supporting people to make that change?
Oh, let's be absolutely clear. If the government could write a big check for everybody to do the right thing all the time, then you wouldn't be attaching the word punitive to any of it, would you? That makes it very easy. But of course, we know that the government cannot write a big check all the time. And we do have examples where even when we were writing a check, it didn't necessarily mean take up. As I recall, and I don't have the detail, the roof insulation policy of some years ago, when it was being offered to people, people were not taking it up. Just writing a check doesn't always do it. So there is a, you know, there's a bit of an issue in there that we've got to watch. But you could say in general terms, yes, if government introduces that sort of scheme, then that makes it easy for everybody. But then governments have got to be worrying about budgets. They've got to be thinking about what's doable. They've got to say to themselves, well, actually, if we offer Mark Ruskell this scheme, is that fair? Considering the amount of money we would be giving Mark Ruskell to do it, could perhaps be better put towards those people who are less able to afford it. So there are still questions inside that. Okay. I mean, I think these are all things that the next parliament is going to have to grapple with. These are all very tricky issues, and it won't be the same answer in every area. It's not just going to be an across-the-board thing.
Okay, thanks. You've already spoken a bit this morning.
And I need to say, should say as well that, you know, Chris Stark has obviously said a lot of things, and I appreciate the committee wants to focus on some of the things that they feel might create a problem for government. But he also said some very complimentary things, and one of the complimentary things he said was that he was very impressed with the engagement strategy of the Scottish Government, which was published at the same time as the Climate Change Plan update, and for which there is absolutely no equivalent at UK level.
Okay. So you mentioned earlier on about negative emissions technologies. It's quite a big bet. 24% cut in emissions by 2032. So I know you've already commented on it, but I just wanted to ask you, are there other alternative investments that were considered? Is there effectively a backup plan for this? I mean, for example, had some evidence that using wood in construction or investing in natural capital might be an alternative way to get a big chunky reduction like that. How risky is it?
I think first of all it needs to be said, and I'm basically going to go back to Chris Stark again, or the CCC again, that the CCC themselves are confident that the NETS technologies are a credible pathway to reaching net zero. We've accepted the advice of the CCC on this, but we did think it was worth putting into a separate chapter, which is in a sense not how it's been presented before, particularly because of some of the issues that you are actually referring to here, because there are some uncertainties around it. Now, we've talked a bit about it before already. A plan B, a plan C, you know, what we've cast here, I suppose, is our best estimate of how well we can achieve this by the 2030 target date. We are confident that it's technically possible by 2030. And that does include trial and demonstration projects, which would mean large scale installations by 2030, which is why we've kind of got that 29 date in there, if you like. It's going to be challenging. I don't think there's any doubt about it. But what we're trying to do is set out a need for an urgent focus on this technology by both governments, by both Scottish and UK government, because both governments do have a need and an incentive to support and develop this. There's a lot of work that will have to go around that, a lot of thinking that we will have to put into it. There are potentially alternative things, but it is absolutely critical that we develop all the options for reducing emissions. We've got carbon capture and storage, hydrogen, negative emissions technologies, all in parallel with the focus on decarbonising other decarbonising areas. So I think it's important to flag that up. There is on the one hand a big reliance on, if you like, the nature-based solutions as well, which I've said before I tend not to categorise in the same space as carbon capture and storage, because mostly that it, what's being considered there is actually about the technologies around, particularly around fossil fuels. There are alternatives already built into the climate change plan update, and we will continue to do that. But we do know that oil and gas is such a big part of our economy that we have to work very hard in that transition and in that area, and in that kind of sphere of technological potential, to try and deliver some of the big wins that in a sense we've already delivered over the past decades through the energy sector.
Mark, okay. Could I thank you. Angus, you have some questions around this area of just transition.
Yes, thank you, convener. Following on from Mark Ruskell's theme, another thing that we heard from Chris Stark was that there's plenty of scope to supply biomass domestically, but that there's only really potential for two decarbonised industrial clusters in the UK. So if Grangemouth wanted to benefit from funding and investment, which it clearly does, then it would have to lean in to capture the lion's share of support. Now, the main internal competition seems to be from Teesside, who are engaging widely, and Humberside's also been mentioned more recently. So suggestion would seem to be that Scotland needs to up its game in this regard. But that said, I know the Scottish Government is liaising closely with Falkirk Council and INEOS and other major players in the sector in Grangemouth with regard to a decarbonised industrial sector, or cluster, sorry. So whilst Scotland has significant advantage in terms of engineering expertise and geological storage for CCS, there's also competition, as I mentioned, from Teesside. So how can Scotland capture the economic and just transition benefits? And also, how important is it that Grangemouth sits at the heart of a low-carbon industrial transformation for Scotland, and what's been done to support this?
Well, I've already talked about just transition benefits, which are threaded through the CCPU in a variety of sectors. And we do believe that NETS will offer those similar opportunities in comparison to the other zero carbon and renewable technologies in the update. So so that's kind of really important. CCUS is an important transition opportunity for us. I've already referred to the huge role oil and gas plays throughout the Scottish economy. So it's a really important part of that. We're putting a lot of time and effort into developing training and skills associated with it, supporting reskilling and retraining skilled workers, and being part of the Energy Scotland Alliance. In terms of the competition between Grangemouth and Teesside, I would hope ultimately that there is room for both, that it would be unfortunate if it was seen as an either or, since there is a capacity for both. If the CCC is of the view that there's room for two, then that, you know, one would hope that Scotland is one of those two. We are putting an enormous amount of effort into what we're actually doing. I think it's really important that we continue to do so. I think that the ACORN project should be seen as an anchor project, which would enable the early establishment of CCU in the UK. I don't believe that the UK government can ignore that reality. I think the ambition both in Scotland and across the UK should be able to encompass that. And Grangemouth, in particular, obviously, it's an important indeed strategic industrial site, and effectively that has to be harnessed as an asset in the energy transition. And there's promising early potential for large-scale hydrogen CCU, and so this could act as a critical catalyst hub for wider decarbonisation across Scotland. But it will take a continued commitment there. It's a geographical priority for decarbonisation efforts, but it does take a continued commitment, and that commitment will have to be continued not just through the next Parliament, but beyond into the Parliament after that. But we are in an area where there's a kind of balance of reserved and devolved responsibilities, which will impact in this sector. Private sector investment, I think, is as much a necessity here as government intervention. And by government intervention, I mean both governments. But we are putting significant Scottish Government funding into it. I'm very much hopeful that that will show dividends.
Can I move us on to talking about waste and the circular economy? Mark, you have some questions on this, then I'll come back to Angus.
Yeah, thanks. Not the first time I've raised this issue with the Cabinet Secretary, but we've had evidence from stakeholders concerned about the growth of waste incinerators. And I wanted to ask you how that sits within the climate change plan. There is a concern that this will lock in emissions and that we need much better national coordination of planning of incineration capacity. Can I ask you what consideration you've given to that? Because stakeholders' voices on this are getting louder, and you would have seen probably, you know, negative comments coming from Zero Waste Scotland about the impact of incineration as well.
Well, I mean, the truth is that we still need capacity to dispose of residual waste while we make the transition to a circular economy. So there is, I seem to recall a meeting that we had in, it must be in 2019, I think, where you yourself were present, Mark, where we worked through all of this, so that there is a kind of need for it up until we make that complete transition. I guess the concern is once you've built the need that people will want to keep feeding the need rather than making the transition. And that is certainly not, from our perspective, how we're proceeding. We are preparing for the 2025 landfill ban, and we have committed to extending it to include biodegradable non-municipal wastes, although there will be need for appropriate consultation and work. I think it needs to be said as well that waste incineration is strictly regulated in line with EU standards, and under these regulations, SEPA do operate a rigorous permitting system for energy from waste operators. In terms of a new national approach, work is actually underway to provide a centrally supported procurement solution to help remaining local authorities secure alternative residual waste treatment solutions to comply with the 2025 ban. So we're already working across across the country to do that. There are other broader commitments in terms of reducing the amount of waste we produce and the proportion of waste that is recycled. And the collaborative procurement, we aim to ensure that expected reductions in residual waste are taken into account when procuring energy from waste capacity. So it's getting a dovetailing of that to avoid local authorities procuring more capacity than they're actually going to need in the future. So it is kind of trying to manage the crossover point as effectively as possible. But there is no intention to bake it in to the future. That is not what we're setting about doing.
Can I bring in Angus MacDonald on more questions around circular economy?
Okay, thanks, convener. The draft TCPU commits to embedding circular economy principles across sectors as part of the green recovery, prioritising areas with the biggest opportunities, including construction and procurement. So can I ask, why are there no tangible commitments in the plan, for example, to deliver circular economy strategies for priority sectors? And in addition, stakeholders have called for a recommitment to a circular economy bill to set out a framework for a transition to a circular economy. But does the Scottish Government still consider that primary legislation is needed in this area? And if so, why is there no commitment to the bill in the plan?
Your frequent reminder that this is not an encyclopedic plan. This is an update to an existing plan taken over a short period of time, and with no expectation that we would cover every single aspect of what could be covered. And I need to keep saying that, because there is a tendency, I think, for us to assume that everything has to be in everything. And that was simply not going to be possible here. The update does identify that we will embed circular economy principles into our wider green recovery, and that it would prioritise areas with the biggest opportunities: construction, agriculture, food and drink, energy and renewables, procurement, skills and education, and plastics. So work is ongoing to develop work plans and associated policies for each of those areas. That work is ongoing and it will be made available in due course. So I presume the successor committee to this in the next parliament will be on the receiving end of much of that much more specific work that will fold out from the update. In terms of the recommitment to a circular economy bill, I mean, obviously, everybody is aware that there was going to be a circular economy bill, but because of the pandemic, we took a decision to delay introduction, and the delay in introduction, because it was a year five bill, has meant that it doesn't happen in the lifetime of this parliament. We do, however, remain committed to achieving circular economy outcomes. I've just described what the proposals are for work across a number of different areas flagged up in the update. We're dealing effectively with an aspect of it tomorrow. In terms of future legislation, it will be for the new administration to decide what legislation it brings forward in the next session of Parliament, and indeed when it wants to do so. So I can't say what will be in a programme for government in September. There is, however, as everybody knows, work already done on a draft circular economy bill.
Thank you. Can I come to Claudia Beamish?
Thank you, convener. And if we could turn our discussions, Cabinet Secretary, to strategic land use. I'd like to explore with you the further development of the regional land use strategy, and indeed the land use strategy itself, which has come up a lot in our stakeholder engagement. Is the Scottish Government, I know that you are committed, rather, I'll rephrase that, to further land use pilots, but some argument that it might be more appropriate in the climate emergency to have a general rollout, and there is a concern has been expressed about those who aren't involved in future pilots being left behind. I wonder if you could comment on that, please.
Well, a general rollout right now without establishing the best way forward may lead to us making a lot of mistakes. The point about the pilots is is to test different approaches to see which works best. And it may be that we don't have a one size fits all. In fact, I would have thought it's quite likely that we end up not with a one size fits all. A general rollout, you know, kind of presumes a one size fits all, and I don't necessarily think that works. So what we've tried to do with the 5 land use partnership pilot regions is to put real work into developing our approach to land use, and it's about optimizing land use appropriately in the area that you're in. And I would have hoped that people saw that as a plus. A general rollout would have been making, you know, decisions centrally about what was and was not going to work, and then effectively imposing that on a situation, which I don't think would have been a particularly helpful way forward. So I mean, that's why we've chosen to do what we've chosen to do. I'm hoping that people understand that. Not an avoidance of decision making, it's an attempt to make the decision making better and more effective.
That's just a bit of a puzzle to me, Cabinet Secretary, because the two pilots that have come online already have been very different in their implementation, and that has depended very much on an ethos which I hope you'll agree with, and I'm sure you do, that they should be inclusive of all the different stakeholders. So surely if it was rolled out more generally, then that would be the case with any of the new areas that were going to be rolled out. Could you just clarify that for me, please?
Well, you know, we've chosen 5 completely different areas. So, you know, the two older ones, which I think date back to 2013, weren't really what wasn't involved in their thinking was the kind of climate scenario that we are now thinking about. So, you know, the decision has now been made. We're not suddenly going to reverse that decision. So, I mean, I'm basically calling on everybody involved in the pilot projects to work as effectively as they can. And help us achieve, from our perspective, the best outcomes for everybody.
Right, thank you. And if I could move on to nature-based solutions, I'm just getting some questions up, and particularly look at the expiration a little further on peatlands. And I'd like to ask you what mechanisms will be used to phase out horticultural peat, and whether you have concerns about the live action that are coming through now and may come through in the future for the extension of sites, and what the Scottish Government position is on those. There's been a lot of concern raised about that. Thank you.
Well, I've had discussions with people, including external stakeholders, about this. Officials are currently continuing to work through some of the issues around the commercial peat extraction and the use of horticultural peat. It isn't as straightforward as people may think. You know, there are different suggestions put forward. One is a sales ban, and a sales ban does sound simple because until you think about the necessity for that to be a UK-wide approach to work, so it immediately becomes a little bit more complicated. And if it wasn't a UK-wide approach, then it wouldn't be as impactful in reducing the extraction of Scottish peat if it was done through a sales ban, so that's an issue that we've got to think about. We've got to move an entire industry away from reliance on peat, which is a slightly different aspect of it, and clearly that means making suitable alternatives readily available. So there's a conversation with the industry that has to be had about that. And there are particular issues impacting on that. A ban on peat extraction for example, which is another one that's brought forward as a way to tackle this, is likely to be very costly because I'm sure, as members of the committee know, these sites can have very lengthy planning permissions. I think at the moment the planning permissions for different sites in Scotland, from the research that we've done, extends from those that may run out this year to those that do not run out until 2051. And there are compensation implications to banning extraction. There would need to be a very significant conversation to be had about whether or not diverting funds from peatland restoration to buy out land which is currently commercial extraction is the right thing to do, because it can be very expensive. We have some examples where the purchase price has been very expensive where it has been done. So there is a conversation that has to be had about a good use of money, which in and of itself might stop some extraction here, but it wouldn't stop imports of peat from elsewhere. So we're circling back around to the sales ban conversation with the horticultural industry itself. So actually, it's not quite as simple and straightforward when you look very closely at it as you might think. Now, the meetings that I've been having, we are holding further meetings in the future. So this is an ongoing conversation. We are looking at mechanisms available, and also we are liaising with DEFRA in relation to UK approaches and including levies. So we are actually actively looking across the board at how we might work this through. In respect of the final bit of your question about the not supporting applications for new commercial peat extraction, I go back to some of the things that I said about existing permissions and the potential for big compensatory claims to result from that.
Also, could I just ask you on that about the extension of existing sites, which is something that's been highlighted to us a lot?
The recent NPF4 position statement did lay down our intention not to support applications for planning permissions for new commercial peat extraction for horticultural purposes. And that includes an extension to an existing site.
That's very helpful, thank you. But
that still circles back around to the potential for compensatory kind of funds to be made available, this is all a more complicated and bigger conversation than it appears at first on the surface.
Thank you.
Can I bring in Angus MacDonald some questions on deer management?
Okay, thanks, convener. Turning to that long-running saga, given the wealth of recommendations in the deer working group report and the recognition from the group that deer management is a key enabling policy for climate mitigation, why has there not been any progress on deer management policy as part of the draft PCPU?
My frequent reminder that this was not meant to be a climate change plan. It was not meant to be encyclopedic. People will always be able to say this or that aspect of policy has not been included. So there we are, my repeat reminder. However, the 2021 programme for government did lay out a commitment to publishing our response to the report by the DEAR Working Group this parliamentary term. As everybody will realise, that means it is imminent. Our response will obviously flag up the intention for the future, which may or may not require legislative change. The PFG did recognise the important role of effective deer management in supporting the green recovery and tackling climate change. Can you just hold on a second? My radio has come on automatically. Sorry about that. When we do respond, it will cover all the recommendations made by the group, including those on deer density limits and deer impacts, etc. I am also very conscious of the read across of this particular area of policy into the question of peatland restoration, because there's a significant dynamic between the two.
Okay, we certainly look forward to seeing that when it comes out, hopefully very soon. I can assure you, Cabinet Secretary, I am taking on board your frequent reminders.
Can I come back to Claudia Beamish with some questions on blue carbon?
Thank you very much, Convener. And the committee has heard that there are opportunities through the National Marine Plan for spatial management and for the separation of mobile and static fishing gear targeted to known blue carbon hotspots. How will Scottish Government ensure that the Blue Economy Action Plan, which we very much welcome, or I certainly do anyway, I shouldn't speak for the whole committee, reconciles the need to ensure protection of natural capital such as blue carbon and marine biodiversity hotspots with socioeconomic priorities for our coastal communities?
Well, the first and most important thing I have to remind everybody about is that blue carbon is not currently included in the UK greenhouse gas inventory. It means that policies and proposals in this space could not contribute to progress to meeting Scotland's statutory emissions targets, which in turn means that they do fall outside the formal scope of the CCPU of necessity. And I just need to flag that out at the outset. I know that Claudia Beamish has had a long-standing interest in blue carbon. We've had some conversations about this before, and I can reassure her that work is continuing, particularly on the research side. One of the reasons why it's not in the greenhouse gas inventory is because the research as yet makes it tricky to see how one could do the measurements to ensure that the inclusion of it would be sensible and productive. So the research is ongoing in respect of that. We are obviously
Cabinet Secretary, just on the research, just so that we clarify that bit before we go on to the hotspots and the question I asked. Just that in committee, we did hear from Professor at St Andrews, and I'm sorry, I only remember his first name. Apologies, it's Bill. But we can go back to that. But the evidence given by him was that particularly salt marshes and seagrasses readily fit into the internationally recognised frameworks for greenhouse gas inventories, and Is it not possible to consider these to properly account for carbon blue stocks? And I understand what you're saying about that it's not in the international, in the recognised inventory per se, but this just seems such a fundamental opportunity to contribute. So we seem to have moved so much faster with peatlands than we have with blue carbon. And I wonder whether we might action as well.
So the short answer to your question is yes. Inclusion is being considered, and yes, we are supportive of it. The longer answer is right now it would not count towards our our targets because it would not be counted. And therefore, as interesting and as important and as likely in the future that it becomes so, trying to include it in this last year in a climate change plan update, you know, would have been to divert our attention. The slightly longer answer is that decisions will be made solely by BEIS on this. Decisions on technical changes to the UK inventory, including the issues around salt marshes and seagrasses, are made solely by BEIS. So we will continue to work with UK counterparts. I know that they are, there is work going on. We support that addition. But ultimately the decision will not be made by us, it will be made by BEIS. And I don't know
sorry to interrupt you, Cabinet Secretary. It was really in relation to the evidence, which is the context. But just in terms of the actual substance of the question in relation to the National Marine Plan and the separation of mobile and static fishing gear, I wonder if there's any comment you can make on that in terms of protection.
You know, we're reviewing the National Marine Plan, and that review will be informed by the very recently published Scottish Marine Assessment 2020. I'm not sure whether the committee's had that yet. It was, I'm trying to think when I did the video conference on it, run up to Christmas, I think. So it's fairly recent. The review is assessing the effectiveness of the current National Marine Plan. What we will then consider is whether a new or amended plan would be necessary to drive forward marine priorities. The future fisheries management strategy is obviously a vital element of that. Our bigger vision, if you like, is to establish and grow the recognition of blue as a natural capital asset in Scotland that will significantly contribute to economic recovery and enable us to make that green recovery if we don't start to get too mixed up in terms of the colours. I'm aware that there is a bit of court action on this. I know that we're considering the court's decision very carefully. The case was very focused. I think there's aspects that are still live, so I think we need to be a bit careful about saying much more about that. The future fisheries management strategy was published before Christmas, just before Christmas as well. That does set out a vision for sustainable and responsible fisheries management. The action plan contained in that will help address the challenges identified by the assessment, the Scottish Marine Assessment, and the actions do include introducing a new catching policy and other aspects of fisheries, which probably could make up an entire committee session on its own. So I'm not sure quite how much more you want me to say about this.
I think that's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Claudia. I mean, Cabinet Secretary, we're coming to the end of this panel. You'll be pleased to hear it's been a long session. I do have one final question. You've alluded throughout your evidence, and we know that a lot of action in reserved areas is going to be necessary to get us to our targets. And you've mentioned the organisation of the gas grid for one. The Internal Market Act. The implications of the Internal Market Act on decisions that we can make in the devolved sphere, how much do you see that potentially impacting what the Scottish Government can do in the policy areas required to get us to those targets?
Well, I mean, it like a lot of these things, you'd have to say the potential is pretty massive to have an impact on what we do and potentially undermine what we do. Government officials are undertaking a serious analysis at the moment to try and map out the Act's impacts across devolved policy areas so that we get a much clearer understanding right across the board. Our initial assessment is that it could very significantly undermine the effectiveness of a DRS scheme in a deposit return scheme in Scotland. I've already referred to various other areas where, in effect, decisions at UK level would be, if not fundamental, very important. So we've talked about horticultural peat, won't go into the detail on that anymore. There are other areas where one could see superficially that there might be an impact. At the end of the day, this will depend enormously on decisions made by the UK government to implement parts of this legislation, and I'm not clear quite what their intentions actually are. Suffice to say that the legislation was passed without the Scottish Parliament's consent, and it was passed without the consent of Senedd Cymru as well.
Okay, thank you very much. We're going to suspend for 5 minutes to allow change in panel, and we'll come back with Cabinet Secretary for Finance as well as Cabinet Secretary for Environment. Suspension now. Next item today is an evidence session on the Scottish Government's budget 2021-22. And we welcome back the Cabinet Secretary for Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform, Rosanna Cunningham. And she's joined by the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, Kate Forbes. Welcome to you both. We also have some officials with us from the Scottish Government, Helena Gray, the Deputy Director of Climate Change Domestic Division, Simon Fuller, Deputy Director of RESAS, Mike Palmer, Deputy Director of Marine Planning and Policy, Dougie McLaren, Deputy Director of Public Spending, and Kat White, Joint Head of Infrastructure Strategy, both from the Scottish Government. I think I'd like to address the first question to Kate Forbes, because obviously the budget is dealing with the demands of COVID-19, but it also has to be looking at funding for a green, just and resilient recovery at the same time. Can I ask for the sort of like the high level budget decisions that have been made in order to tackle those twin challenges?
Yes, thanks very much, and good morning to the committee from Dingwall. The budget, as the convener has just said, is trying to do a number of things. And one of the dangers when you're trying to do a number of things, for example, responding to the immediate crisis, but then also setting the groundwork for recovery, is that you lose sight of your objectives. And running through this budget are three very, very clear objectives to try and make sure that we don't lose sight of what we're trying to achieve. And those are obviously responding to the health pandemic, tackling inequalities. But the third one, and importantly for this committee, is that there's also a focus on rebuilding the economy. And I see this moment in time as a crossroads, as an opportunity for Scotland to transition to a green recovery. We have options in front of us, and the options that we have chosen are very much to try and accelerate the transition and accelerate the shift. Now, you can see that in a number of areas. So you can see it in infrastructure. We have intentionally chosen to inject confidence in our economy by investing substantially in infrastructure. But the type of infrastructure we've chosen is very much focused on that transition and on low carbon. So, for example, you see in the budget the increase of low carbon capital investment to over £1.9 billion. Low carbon now comprises 36% of overall capital spend. You'll see the first £165 million of our low carbon fund. You'll see an increase in heat in buildings investments by £30 million. You'll see an increase in forestry investment by £26.9 million, and so on and so forth. So that's point number one on infrastructure. The second, though, is on job creation and job retention, because if we are going to see that transition, and right now we need to do all that we can to both save as well as create new jobs, we need to ensure that there's a pipeline of skills. And what we've chosen to do in the budget is to ensure that all our employability, upskilling, reskilling programmes are aligned with the future of our economy, the future direction of our economy. So you'll see, for example, when it comes to employability, the Green Jobs Fund, that's to develop, grow and create good green jobs. £25 million for bus priority infrastructure, £15 million for zero emissions buses, all as part of our low carbon fund. And alongside that, and within it, the approach to ensuring that we've got the pipeline of talent and skills that we need when it comes to that investment. So just two short answers and in a long answer around what our objectives are and how we ensure that the recovery takes advantage of the opportunities to transition and ensure that there's money there for reskilling as well as for infrastructure itself.
And just as you've mentioned, I mean, green recovery and the climate change ambitions do touch a lot of areas of government in terms of policy decisions, but they will also have to attract the budgets and spending that goes along with that. And that was for
Sorry, sorry, that was a question. Yes, that's right. So two parts to your question. The first being, when it comes to building the budget, obviously Rosanna Cunningham has one of the that she's probably one of the few alongside myself who has a portfolio that touches everybody else's portfolio. And when it comes to the budget, I have overall oversight, as it were, to make sure that everything we're doing contributes towards our three objectives that I just outlined. And Rosanna Cunningham's job is to make sure that right across government, we are investing to meet our very challenging climate change ambitions. Now, I am clear that public money alone will not meet our climate change ambitions in isolation. It's got to be about leveraging and private investment as well. So you need to look at the budget alongside other policy areas. If you take the Scottish National Investment Bank as one example, there's public money there, but it's with a view to leveraging in private investment as well. And some of our more substantial investments are done alongside community groups, voluntary groups, third sector, as well as private sector as well.
I want to bring in Rosanna Cunningham because one of the areas where Scotland has benefited in the past from EU funding has been in around environment and climate change. And I know that, for example, they have got a very big fund for just transition that we no longer will be able to apply for, obviously not being a member anymore. I mean, just how much has that relationship with regards to not being in the EU impacted on the budget for the area of environment and climate change, Cabinet Secretary?
Well, it's already impacting on some of the thinking and decisions. Let's say it's the uncertainty that currently is in place about what might replace the EU funding is already impacting on some of what we have to think about doing. So you know, it's a real concern that we have an existing for big funds in my area that impact in terms of my portfolio, the existing European Regional Development Fund, the ERDF, programs such as the Circular Economy Programme and the Green Infrastructure Investment Fund are going to continue to their conclusion in 2022-23. But what we don't know yet is what the UK government is committing to replacing that with. So, you know, this is a headache both for our decision making, but also for Kate Forbes' forward budget planning as well, because the degree of uncertainty is quite significant. We've discussed in the earlier session the Internal Market Act, which in itself includes provisions that presume Whitehall control over the delivery of EU programme funding replacements in Scotland, which have been delivered successfully in Scotland by Scottish ministers of different administration colours, been delivered successfully for decades. And EU programme funding replacements, if they're not actually delivered within Scotland to Scottish priorities, it then becomes a problem of policy / funding mismatch completely. So that becomes a big issue in and of itself. I mean, even leaving aside the kind of principal issue around what that might mean. You know, there are huge uncertainties within which we are currently having to make a decision. And you know, we've had an entire session of the committee earlier this morning where longer term decision making is absolutely vital, but some of which is impacted by the uncertainties around how and in what way we might be able to fund all of this ourselves going forward, and can we rely on a different government with potentially different priorities, considering our priorities in any way, if they choose to be in control of the funding. So there's a big issue there. We are doing the best we can with the powers that we have right now to mitigate the worst impacts of EU exit. But we've been absolutely blunt with everybody that we are not going to be able to mitigate all of the impacts completely. And that is just an unfortunate truth. And you know, there is a specific area that I could flag up as an example of this, and that's the marine area. As a result of EU exit, there were 86 new powers in relation to marine policy, and around 500 obligations that were previously undertaken by the European Commission or member states, but which have now been transferred to Scottish ministers. This is the other side of the coin. Those new obligations, both statutory and non-statutory, couldn't be met from within the existing baseline without impacting on the delivery of Marine Scotland's already existing statutory responsibilities. So it's been essential that adequate additional resources have been allocated to ensure delivery of this business critical work. So there's a direct impact of what has happened already on the existing budget within my portfolio. So the impacts are profound. Potentially speaking, the impact of the Internal Market Act could be profound. At the moment, what we are dealing with is an unprecedented degree of uncertainty around this area, which is quite separate to the impact and uncertainty of the pandemic on budgets. So we have two huge areas of concern. Kate Forbes is right to point up that, you know, I'm, you know, touching on just about every portfolio. I certainly don't envy her job. I doubt she envies me mine.
Thank you. Can I come to some questions on the climate change plan from Finlay Carson?
Thank you, Convener. The committee has at the moment is scrutinising the climate change plan that we've already heard. And through that process, we've repeatedly called for the Scottish Government for their budget to align with our climate change ambitions. Now, whilst we know that the Climate Change Emissions Reduction Act 2019 didn't require the costs and benefits to be tied up, however, what I would like Kate Forbes to answer is, how can the Scottish Government actually demonstrate that the budget put forward will align with the climate change plan update, so that we can actually see that there's the chance of it delivering on our climate change targets in 2030?
Questions that we face. Now, in my opening remarks, I mentioned that in designing the budget, we've got to be really clear about our objectives. And I'm under no illusions as to how challenging our climate change plan is. And therefore, the design of the budget has to go hand in glove with the climate change plan, or else it's not credible. And we have got to use every penny at our disposal to try and meet that plan alongside the other objectives we have, not least responding to a pandemic. So right at the heart of the build of the budget is this point around green recovery. Now, that includes the proposals in our programme for government, last year's programme for government, as well as the climate change plan. And this year's budget definitely builds on previous commitments, and you can see that running through the budget. It's also laying foundations to rebuild as well, and it includes implementation of the climate change plan update. Now, if I were to use specific examples, you can see initial allocations for the low carbon fund, which I mentioned in my opening remarks. You can see complementary investments like in active travel, peatlands, biodiversity, skills. We've discussed this at length in previous committee sessions, but if you take peatlands as one example, last year we announced the landmark £250 million 10-year commitment to support restoration, including large-scale multi-year restoration programmes for peatlands. And in this year's budget, you'll see the £22 million included as part of that £250 million target. You'll also see substantial increase in forestry investment. So all of that aligns with our broader support for business, trying to revitalise the economy, which I've already talked about. You know, and you see that through the increase in fund for enterprise agencies, you see that in the Green Jobs Fund, etc. But alongside that, it has been designed hand in glove with the climate change plan. And of course, the last point I would make is that this year's budget, the timescales of it have been really uncertain and really challenging. So ordinarily it would have been in December, and Rosanna and I meet very regularly, and certainly met very regularly in advance of both the climate change plan update and the budget, to make sure that our officials were joined up, our teams were joined up, and we were joined up. Unfortunately, the timetable meant that the budget went later than expected, or else it might have been published on the same day. So, you know, we try and build it hand in glove. If there's more that we can do to draw out the way in which that's done, or the way in which the budget aligns with the climate change plan, I'm up for it. Sorry, very last point. I've already said this, but we cannot meet climate change ambitions through public money alone. So it's increasingly clear that the policies that we designed need to draw in additional private investment on top of public money that's in the budget. That will need to use innovative financing mechanisms. It will need to look at regulation. It will need to signal clear pathways for the transition. And I do have quite regular meetings with businesses and investors on how we can make sure Scotland as a regulatory environment attracts that private investment, in order to ensure that private money is working with public money to meet those ambitions.
Okay, thank you. But that doesn't appear to be working in practice. I know you're saying you're talking to business, because in written evidence to on the CCPU to the Economy, Energy and Fair Work Committee, the Scottish carbon capture and storage industry had significant concerns the infrastructure plan might not be fit for purpose, and that the plan didn't consider industrial decarbonisation, and consequently, and I quote, the plan does not adequately consider infrastructure needs relating to CCS and hydrogen, and risks hampering their deployment. So how will the Scottish Government ensure that NETS will remove nearly 25% of the gross emissions from Scotland's 2032 target without a plan that includes infrastructure to do so?
So the CCPU, sorry, I'm answering this, but if Rosanna wants to come in at any point, the CCPU committed us to setting up a bioenergy expert working group this year. And that group will advise on the most appropriate and sustainable use for resources, the volume of resources that we can produce within Scotland, and the level of import that we believe is compatible with a sustainable global trade in bioenergy. So the CCPU lays out a plan to respond to the risk by 2023. However, it also includes clear actions to continually review progress of developing NETs. I think the principle there is that engagement has not stopped. Engagement needs to continue. There are lots of challenges in the months and years ahead. None of us are dismissing how challenging some of this is, but to do it alongside industry, working regularly with industry is important. And secondly, reviewing progress is very important. It's easy to set targets. It's easy to tick a box and say, here's money to do X, Y, or Z. Far more challenging to every step of the way review that progress and work collaboratively with industry and others. So Rosanna may have more to say on NETs, but from my perspective, the way that we do that is, yes, putting the money in place, but even more importantly than that is making sure that we're working collaboratively with industry and then reviewing it, so that we can come in front of committee with reviews and you can challenge me on whether we're meeting that every step of the way.
Can I come in, convener?
Yes.
Yeah, I kind of feel I do have to go back to Finlay Carson's question and challenge around industrial decarbonisation, which he specifically referenced. I think what's really, really important is to remember that is not something that is wholly in the Scottish Government's gift. It is part and parcel of one of the issues that we grapple with the split between devolved and reserved powers. And quite separately, I am in regular discussions with the kind of Four Nation Net Zero group, which is, amongst other things, wanting to press for that. The discussions that took place about the setting up of the UK ETS to replace the EU ETS, which the committee knows was a final decision taken almost at the 11th hour, also included significant conversations about industrial decarbonisation, because in some respects, industrial decarbonisation is going to have to be a decision taken at a UK level. Now, we have these conversations on a very regular basis, but unless those UK decisions are made in respect of that, Scotland will always be left with effectively trying to implement solutions in the absence of that wholesale decarbonisation process. And that is, you know, just one of the realities of where we currently are. So is there a valid criticism to be made about the lack of that wholesale decarbonisation? Well, yes, of course there is. But these are not necessarily solutions that the Scottish Government can step in and provide complete answers to. It cannot.
Finlay, can I move on?
Yeah, well, just on the back of that, so I take that on board that it's there may be decisions that the UK government makes which will influence the outcomes. But what will the funds that you propose actually deliver? And do you think it's adequate to put the industry to put the decarbonisation infrastructure in place? So just looking at the bit you're responsible for, will they deliver?
Well, with the greatest of respects, until we know what the UK government is going to commit to, it is very difficult to know what will be necessary for us. And there are huge dangers in this for us, because there are dangers in us making decisions that put money places where the UK government doesn't make decisions, and not putting money into places where the UK government does. I mean, this has to work across both the UK government and the Scottish government, which is why I wanted to flag up that there were these conversations ongoing, that we are not unmindful of the real gain to be had here, but also the danger of missteps if we don't do it properly. So, you know, I can point to things and say, well, we think that would be helpful intervention. But the fact of the matter is, without clear commitment from elsewhere as well, we won't know whether or not the decisions that we've made about where to put money will in the long term turn out to have been the right decisions. I mean, for example, if the UK government does decide to decarbonise the gas grid, the difference that makes in some of the choices that we might have to make are pretty significant. If we have to make decisions not knowing what that final outcome is going to be, we may be putting money into places that is effectively designing workarounds to something which would more simply be delivered on that UK-wide level. I mean, I don't want this to always be seen as a criticism. It is one of the difficulties that arises when there is a bit of a mismatch in conversations, a mismatch in timing, and perhaps in some cases, I not just as much on the ball as it might have been. But these conversations are being had for precisely the reason that Finlay Carson is raising.
But can I just on that, so I presume that the ambitions you've got are based, and the amount of money you're investing in this are based on positive discussions and positive interaction with the UK government? That's what you based your assumptions on?
No, we're basing our assumptions on our best estimate of what we can do, what we can achieve within the powers that are available to us. There is a great deal more that can be unlocked that will deliver the wholesale decarbonisation that we all want to see, but which require decisions to be made at the UK government level. And until they're made at that level, we will not actually see, and that's threaded through the CPU, the CCPU. We've flagged that up. And the CCC recognises that as well. They've challenged us to use our powers to the maximum to achieve what we can achieve. But they also recognise that there is a requirement on another government in order to use its powers to the maximum as well.
OK, thank you.
Thank you. Can I move on to questions from Claudia Beamish?
Thank you, Convener. And I'm going to be asking some questions on nature-based solutions to recovery and tackling the ecological crisis. My colleague Mark Ruskell will come in on some of those as well. So could I direct my two questions to yourself, Rosanna, please? And of course, if Kate feels it's appropriate to come in, I'm sure that you will. So at what extent does the infrastructure investment plan reflect recommendations to incorporate natural infrastructure? I mean, many of us were very pleased that green and blue infrastructure were recognised in the plan. And so what opportunities are there to deliver nature-based solutions through financial commitments in the areas that you're working on? Thank you.
Well, the Infrastructure Commission did, and you know, I need to preface this by pointing out that this is not actually something delivered through my own portfolio. So I have to tread, as always, tread a little carefully. The Infrastructure Commission did recognise infrastructure's role beyond the economy and its support for social and environmental policy outcomes. These discussions go back quite a long way. In terms of how things are classified, there are lots of technical issues around it. We did take the Commission's views on board consulted on the draft infrastructure plan to get the right final approach. And the inclusion of natural infrastructure, I think, got almost universal support. We've confirmed our new definition in the plan that was published last Thursday. We actually believe, not for the first time, that Scotland is a bit of a world leader on this, because we think this is now one of the widest infrastructure definitions in use internationally. It means that we can take a more holistic view of our infrastructure assets, and people will know all of the benefits that might have. And a lot of the programmes do already integrate nature-based solutions into their delivery. Flood management, water, wastewater programmes, regeneration, housing, etc. So that's already being integrated. And the budget also does support investment in green networks, in partnership with others like the Green Infrastructure Strategic Intervention Fund managed by Nature Scot. So, you know, there is quite a lot. Oh, and I wouldn't want to miss out the new £50 million vacant and derelict land fund as well. So these are all investments which on an older, narrower definition might not have been included, but are now included. I just need to flag to the committee that the communities portfolio wants to take over the vacant and derelict land fund, even if it's something that has come out of this portfolio. There's a bit of vying for interest in this, which I think is a very good thing, because it does show the cross-portfolio importance of a lot of these decisions. So, I think. The answer to Claudia's question is to a very great extent, it delivers a lot of opportunities, and I think it will attract some significant interest internationally as well, as did our commitment to nature-based solutions financially at the beginning of last year.
Right, thank you. And could I just ask, was the possibility of front-loading investments in nature-based solutions explored as part of the budget? For you've highlighted one or two that are there, but to give another example, more broadly based landscape scale ecological programmes might be another, as well as the use of I'm giving another as well now, but the use possibly of multi-annual contracts for peatland restoration. Were those things explored? I don't know if you'd like to answer that, Rosanna, or if
Kate. They were. Kate Forbes did talk about the frequent meetings that she and I have I can reassure members that these comprise subject matter for many of our conversations. Yes, the peatland restoration is an obvious one. The massive, massive financial uplift in terms of the budget, both in the immediate year and in the years to come. We've just got to watch it, particularly in that we've got to actually match the short-term investment to the capacity of the industry. So we don't want to outrun capacity issues, and that's we hope the investment at the same time as delivering in terms of peatland restoration will also deliver in terms of capacity growth, which is pretty important. So we are very much encouraging multi-annual landscape scale proposals for it to be game changing. So you know, the front loading investment if it can be done effectively is a good thing, but you've got to be careful that you're not simply overburdening a particular sector or industry with something that is unachievable in the very short term if they need that longer time to build capacity.
Thank you.
I'm not quite sure if Kate Forbes wants to come in the back of that. No.
Probably
right.
Not.
I will move on then to questions from Mark Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I wanted to ask about the Agri-Environment Climate Scheme, which has really been pretty central to what we're trying to do to tackle both the nature and the climate emergencies. But under this year's budget, it seems to have had a 20% cut. Now, I understand that there are around 1,300 agreements with farms and crofters that are coming to an end this year. And the last thing we want to see is, you know, farmers coming out of organic conversion, you know, not being able to continue with habitat restoration as a result of that. Can I ask why that decision was made? Was there any assessment of what the impact would be on biodiversity of climate of cutting that budget? I recognise this isn't a direct question for BEX, your portfolios, so it's a question to government about why government has decided to make this decision.
Well, it kind of is, Mark. I think you could ask the question of both myself and Fergus Ewing jointly and severally. I can tell you that there were an enormous number of meetings and discussions about what to do with AICs in the current circumstances, and there are huge issues surrounding the decision making. We've got a situation where support for farmers, crofters and land managers to cut emissions, address climate change and do all of those things, of that support, about a third of it is CAP schemes, including greening, AICs, beef efficiency scheme and forestry grant scheme, all providing funding in this area. And as it stands at the moment, Scotland is losing out on £170.1 million of funding through to 2025 that should rightly be spent on our producers and rural communities. And at the moment, we haven't been able to engage substantively on what is a demonstrable funding shortfall. And that situation, I mean, all devolved administrations are currently struggling with this and are effectively making the same points to the UK government. So we are trying to continue to support the SRDP domestically and try to pilot some new approaches between 2021 and 2024. But one of the difficulties with making longer-term commitments that are fixed financial commitments in the absence of any actual understanding of what money is going to be available would be extremely difficult for us to manage. And there were many conversations about how we were going to square this circle. The solution we came up with And I may say that no solution would have been an ideal solution, absent there being an unlimited pot of money, which everybody accepts there isn't. The solution we came up with, we felt was the best adjustment to the situation over the next few years, until we had a far better understanding of what, if any, money was going to become available through and via the new UK presumable replacement funding. But as yet, we don't have any certainty about that. And in the absence of that kind of certainty, it makes that longer term planning. And, that's obviously been a bit of a theme of some of the conversations that we've been having this morning. The longer term planning is extremely difficult. So we made a decision about how to roll out a scheme, and one that from our perspective, we could financially deal with in this period of uncertainty. I think given the conversations that were had, the involvement across the board of people in the discussions across government with Nature Scott and all the rest of it, the what we have come up with is the best solution for the next few years, without us being able to envisage what monies will be available to us in the future.
But that £170 million shortfall, is this not a disproportionate hit on the AIC scheme compared to other parts of the agricultural subsidy and diversification programme?
With the greatest of respect, £170 million shortfall has to be made up from somewhere. We have to be able to deal with that. We have to make decisions about it. There are some things that we need to do. We need to do these farmer-led working groups to get the agriculture emissions down. We need to do a lot of work. There has to be some money available to do that as well. We made what we consider to be, in our judgment, the best possible decision for the next few years. And I'm sure that there will be people that will argue that we could have done something differently. Of course, there would be. But ultimately, we are where we are financially, and we have to know that we can cope with the expenditure that we're committing to.
Okay, if I could turn now to the infrastructure investment plan. There's obviously a renewed focus now through that plan on net zero emissions and on sustainability as well. I'm interested to know, like, how the investments are now being reprioritized as a result of that, and how that comes through this budget. And in particular, there's obviously going to be a lot of capital underspend this year, given the COVID pandemic. Does this offer an opportunity to look again at major infrastructure projects, like, for example, the A9, and rethink those in terms of sustainability, net zero, and the emerging priorities?
If Kate might want to talk about this massive capital underspend, which I wasn't entirely certain I was aware of, if Kate wants to come in on that.
Yes, thanks very much. Mark, I think in a sense there's three timetables attached to your question. There's the immediate this year and COVID impacts on budgets, there's next year's budget, and then there's the capital spending review, or the infrastructure investment plan, which is over the next 5 years. If I could deal briefly with the A9, we are still committed to the A9 as somebody who drives up and down that road, or goes far too often up and down that road. I think it still remains absolutely essential, particularly from a safety perspective, considering that it has one of the highest numbers of fatalities that the road is invested in and upgraded. But moving on to the infrastructure investment plan, you're right in saying that with a particular pot of money, and if you remember back to the UK government spending review in November, capital took a particular hit, took a hit of about 5%. So with the pool that we have got to make choices. And therefore, the fact that you see in this capital budget, 36.9% of the capital budget classed as low carbon, rising from 29% in 2018-2019, shows that in terms of the proportion being low carbon, that has increased. And by extension, that means that some things that we might have liked to do can't go ahead. So the Infrastructure Investment Plan obviously looks ahead at the next 5 years. It's a very robust pipeline of work. It meets our commitment on the £2 billion low carbon fund. It invests substantially in decarbonising heat and energy. And everything that we have done in the low carbon space is money that we haven't used in high carbon intensive infrastructure. Now, that may sound obvious, but as you would imagine, in building the capital spending review, there are always more bids than the money available. So every portfolio will have a number of projects that they would like to progress that can't progress because there isn't sufficient money. So the fact that we have protected the budget, we have seen an increase in a capital budget for low carbon, to me suggests that that transition that we have made in low carbon is backed up by the figures in the capital spending review.
Okay.
Can I bring in Liz Smith, who's a question on the bend?
Thank you. My question is to Kate Forbes, and you mentioned earlier, as did Rosanna Cunningham quite rightly, that this is all about being cross-portfolio and joined up thinking when it comes to policy making. And earlier on this morning, we were looking at the effects of that in terms of transport. And I was just wondering, Ms. Forbes, what your thinking is behind the proposed cut in the budget of £33 million for rail infrastructure, not the other parts of rail budget, but the actual infrastructure, because I would have thought that improving that infrastructure is very much in line with Scottish Government policy when it comes to greener transport.
Thanks very much. And because you asked me it earlier in the week, I actually took it away and spoke to officials about it. So I wonder whether, not to put Cat White on the spot, but I'm wondering if Catherine wants to answer that from the perspective of what makes up our rail infrastructure, because rail is one of those areas that's very cross-government in terms of both devolved and reserved.
Thank you. If we can
just checking you can hear me now.
Okay.
Thank you. Yes, and I'm coming from the infrastructure plan overall, but maybe in some of the specifics we could follow up directly. But the rail infrastructure monies are allocated through three different budgets. So I think big proportion of that is determined with the Office of Rail and Road. So the regulated element is judged on what the infrastructure needs are of the rail network, which is done with the regulator. So we don't have full control over that. And that's the profile that does show a slight decline over that period, if that's what's being referred to. So I suppose some of the rail elements are not fully within our gift, but it does show significant investment in rail projects. And I think what we were pleased to show through the infrastructure investment plan was itemising around 550 million of that spending would go directly onto the rail decarbonisation plan. So there's lots of different elements of the rail spending. But again, within that profile, we are prioritising funding towards decarbonisation too.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. I think that's helpful. Could I just ask the Cabinet Secretary, however, that obviously, that there are issues about behavioural change, and again, we talked a lot about this earlier this morning, and trying to get people out of their cars and into greener transport. And I'm concerned that some of the rail network in Scotland is not seen as an efficient alternative for many people who are driving the cars. And I just wonder if the Scottish Government is really prioritising this as a major encouragement of behaviour change, because as the budget stands at the moment, I'm not convinced that there is that priority when it comes to the infrastructure in rail that's it's really necessary to make that change.
Thanks for that. And I think in terms of the general principle, I would wholeheartedly agree that investing in public transport is essential in terms of helping to change behaviour. I'm very happy to follow up with any specifics on rail, because I think in your original question, you'd specified links within your own region. So very happy to come back in writing on specifics there. But in terms of the wider point, there is obviously substantial investment in decarbonising rail and decarbonising buses, but also investment in making sure that buses in particular are viable and we maintain that local service as far as we can. On rail, the more that we can do, the better to make it more attractive to people, I would agree. And if there's more that you think we can do, then I'm very open to suggestions about rail, not least because I think one of the railway lines that would be a good example of what you're saying in terms of making it more attractive than driving would be right across the Highlands as well. So if the timetable works and if it's frequent enough, then people are more inclined to use rail than otherwise.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's helpful, and perhaps we can follow up at a future date, because I think particularly when it comes to the rail network, if it is the Highlands, but also the Edinburgh to Perth one is definitely in need of some upgrade to ensure that, you know, if you reflect the actual populations and the demographics of Dunfermline and Kinross, Milnathort, etc., you know, I think there is scope there for far more people to be using rail than their cars. And it's just to ensure that the Scottish Government is doing a cost-benefit analysis effectively when it comes to the budget spend about what could affect the necessary change in behaviour. But perhaps I can follow that up with the Cabinet Secretary offline. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And I'll certainly be following up with a letter to the Cabinet Secretary about the fact that the vast swathes of the North East doesn't have any railway infrastructure whatsoever. And I imagine Stuart Stevenson is nodding along as I say that. Can I bring in Angus MacDonald, who has some questions on funding for public services? Angus.
Okay, thank you, Convener. The Cabinet Secretaries will be aware that the committee's pre-budget report recommended that the resource budgets of public organisations considered key to responding to the global climate emergency and biodiversity loss should be protected in real terms. And we see subsequently that Marine Scotland will receive a 21.1% real terms increase. Nature Scot has received no additional fiscal resource, and SEPA has a slight uplift. So given that, why has the committee's recommendation to protect the budgets of public organisations considered key to responding to the global climate emergency and biodiversity loss not been fully met?
Do you want me to answer that?
Yeah, can I direct that at Kate Forbes first? Yeah, please.
Sure. Thanks very much. In terms of Nature Scot, there isn't a cash freeze. So there is an increase in the capital budget for Nature Scot, and that is a key driver of the decarbonising work that they do and the biodiversity work they do. So, for example, the increased capital budget for Nature Scot will enable them to deliver EV fleet vehicles, charging points, essential infrastructure and property maintenance, and work on the national nature reserves and other protected areas. So I would refer the member to the capital budget for Nature Scot. And, you know, as shared with the committee before, I think GIA budgets are not always a good litmus test of the government's commitment on biodiversity and nature-based solutions, etc. If you take Nature Scot's budget, there is £1 million specifically ring-fenced for the Biodiversity Challenge Fund, and that's retained from the increase of their budget last year. There's also an increase from the £3 million that was committed in the Programme for Government to £5 million in dedicated biodiversity funding. And our funding for biodiversity compensates to some extent the UK government's failure to provide clarity on a replacement for the EU life scheme. So I suppose the three short answers I would make about Nature Scot's budget is one, look at the overall budget and you'll see a capital increase. Secondly, look at the substance of the budget and you'll see a real prioritisation of biodiversity work. And then thirdly, looking at the wider context, understanding where we have had to find some of our own replacement funding for funding that's been removed, and you'll see an overall package that really demonstrates the importance that we put on biodiversity and the work of our public bodies in ensuring that we're meeting our targets.
Okay, that's a helpful clarification. Convener, if I could ask a couple of specific questions. One with regard to SEPA. Obviously, there's the ongoing cyber attack, which is likely to have budgetary implications, for example, to enable them to rebuild their online systems. So is that going to be an issue and have budgetary implications? And also, can I ask how funding the programmes for strategic research may change in the next 2022-2027 round, and how the capital budget for research is deployed, and also how future programmes will support the green recovery? And both of these, I think, to Kate Forbes, start with.
Thanks, and Rosanna may want to come in on the SEPA attack in terms of the substance. The financial impact of the attack is still unclear. So we are working very closely with SEPA to try and assess and manage any pressures that arise, both in terms of revenue costs as well as the capital costs of any replacement work. SEPA are currently working through the various priority areas, and they've got specialists looking at, well, doing an analysis of the event to establish what the costs might be. Their IT systems have been compromised. It has had a substantial impact. They anticipate that their systems will need to be built from scratch, not just rebuilt. So you can see that there's ongoing revenue costs of support, but there will also need to be capital costs as well. I can move on to strategic research unless Rosanna wants to come in on anything to do with SEPA and the impact.
No, I think in fairness, it's a question to which we still don't have a precise answer. I've already obviously flagged this to Kate Forbes, and clearly there are discussions. I have asked that as soon as even an estimated cost figure is available, that it be communicated as quickly as possible. But as yet, we don't actually have that because the financial impact of the attack is still unclear. And obviously, right now, SEPA is working through a variety of different priority areas in terms of managing the situation. And they're waiting on reports from specialists to allow them to better understand what the cost of recovery on this will be. I mean, it was a very significant attack. It is going to have a financial impact. At this point, it is very difficult to see what that will be. Kate Forbes is right to flag up that there may be both a resource and a capital impact. As yet, being able to decide the balance there is also extremely difficult. And the anticipation is that the systems will all require to be built from scratch. And that is not rebuilt, but actually built from scratch. So, you know, we are talking about a pretty significant potential piece of work in the future, at the same time as SEPA has to be able to continue delivering core public services. So there will be a financial impact. What that is almost impossible to gauge at this stage until we get the analysis, and how it will be balanced as between resource and capital is as still unable to ascertain. So the issue around that is a bit of a question mark for both of us. But rest assured that there are continuing conversations in this area.
Will I come in on the research? Because the capital spending review allocated around £171 million to the programmes of research. And I think what's really important there is that it provides a longer term commitment to investment and capacity building in the work led by each of our main research providers. And that's really important in terms of that longer term pipeline. And that will clearly support innovation that we know is essential for green jobs, supporting work to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in agriculture, livestock, crops, and new areas which will be funded through the 2022-2027 programme will include in the circular economy and waste. So that multi-year outlook hopefully will help, again, with confidence. And the draft research strategy for the programmes of research was published last year for consultation. We're currently finalising it in response to that feedback, and it sets out that pathway for a significant multi-million pound investment that we're making over the next 5 years.
Okay, thanks. That'll certainly be music to the ears of research organisations, because it has been an issue that's been coming up more recently, year after year, and the longer term commitment will definitely be welcome. If I could turn to my final question, Convener, and it's probably directed at both Cabinet Secretaries, what threats and opportunities has the end of the EU funding streams, such as the structural funds or CAP payments and their domestic replacements, created?
Well, perhaps if I start, I mean, obviously we've had some exchanges already that directly pertain to this particular part of the conversation, so I don't want to simply retread those conversations. The threat at the moment is the continuing significant uncertainty about what is going to replace EU funding streams, and how the replacements for those funding streams are going to be administered. That is the big significant uncertainty right now for the two linked portfolios, my portfolio and the rural economy portfolio, and indeed some of the schemes span both portfolios. So those are that uncertainty is a big issue. The opportunities, I suppose, might be harder to identify given the huge benefits that Scotland, the disproportionately large benefits that Scotland received from EU money in the past. And we did benefit immensely from EU funding streams. So the question becomes, would we expect that same disproportionate benefit continue? Because even if it is argued that it shouldn't continue, the fact is that then means a hit in terms of our funding for, in whatever way, shape or form the future replacement might take. Now, I do know the UK government is currently seeking to secure participation in a number of programmes, but several of them are excluded, and that does include EU Life, which has been incredibly important. What we've tried to do already with the PFG promise of £3 million funding for biodiversity, which has now been increased to £5 million in the budget, is partly to compensate for the loss of access to the EU Life scheme. And it is really, really important that we continue discussions over things like the UK ETS and other aspects. So at the moment, I'm finding it hard to talk in terms of opportunities, given the level of uncertainty. Until there is a level of certainty in what replaces this funding, establishing what the opportunities might be is an extremely difficult thing to do.
I mean, if I see it from a wider perspective, if I take a step back and look at it holistically, as it were, because we can get into the nitty-gritty of each funding stream and debate and discuss, but if I look at it more holistically, the lack of full replacement has an impact right across the Scottish Government's budget, because where things have not been replaced, then funding has got consumed for a funding stream, therefore having an impact on other budget lines, or it remains unfunded. Obviously, we await the UK government's budget on the 3rd of March, but certainly the spending review last November provided insufficient allocations for rural and fisheries and very, very little clarity on the proposed UK Shared Prosperity Fund or the replacement funding for other EU programmes. Now, we've obviously since had commitment that the Shared Prosperity Fund will be managed by the UK government and not ourselves. And, you know, any attempt by the UK government to distribute replacement EU programme funding in areas of devolved competence is, aside from the debate as to whether it's an assault or, on our devolved administration, it does disrupt the budget process. It disrupts the productive relationships we have forged with stakeholders. And it's quite clear that where funding has been committed, it's not sufficient. And I think fisheries is a really good example of that. We've already talked about CAP, but £14 million to support fisheries in Scotland. Those amounts are based on the amount received by each administration, but it won't be available in April 2021. And it fails to recognise that payments by the Scottish Government or payments due to be made is not represented in that £14 million. So long story short, it doesn't cover the funding that we need to continue to support fisheries. It's only for 1 year rather than for multi-year, and it's based on allocations from 2014 and not taking into account inflation. So therefore, it has an impact on all those who would normally be recipients of that EU funding. And if the Scottish Government deems it appropriate to top that up, then that will come from another budget line. So I'm very clear that without full replacement of EU funding, it does have a detrimental budget impact right across the Scottish Government. And nowhere is that more clearly seen than in rural and in environmental schemes.
Cabinet Secretaries, we're running over time, but we do have two more questions to ask. So if you forgive me, we'll maybe just let it run another 5 minutes. Can I come quickly to Finlay Carson and then to Mark Russell?
Thanks, Convener. I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary will be disappointed that on what could be one of our last appearances of the committee, I didn't ask a question on national parks. I'm obviously really pleased to see there's been a 20% uplift in the budget for national parks, which does suggest it's a great vehicle to deliver environmental improvements, whatever. But one of the measures, it says it's to the costs are related to managing visitor pressures. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what measures are going to put in place for the likes of Galloway, which saw a massive increase in visitors with the staycation message? And why does she continue to rule out the small, tiny, insignificant amount of money which would be involved in doing a feasibility study into the national park?
Well, there are no small, insignificant amounts of money when it comes to budgets and an enormous amount of competition for the amounts of money that there are. The question mark over the longer term will always remain. There is always a longer term commitment to consider establishment of other national parks. That doesn't mean to say that there only can be one other proposal. But the member will see clearly from the budget the amounts of monies that are required to be spent on national parks. It would be extremely difficult to see how you could lever in a third pot of money for a third national park, regardless of where that was. And as I always do and always will do, I would point to the numerous other designated attractions in the southwest of Scotland, including the very successful biosphere, which I signed off on as one of my very first ever ministerial decisions in 2009.
Thank you. Can I come to Mark Ruskell finally? Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I think we've had some really constructive discussions over the last couple of years about the need to really climate-proof budgets and understand the long-term implications of some of the spending decisions that are in there. There was a commitment between government and parliament to put in place a joint budget to give us all the tools to really understand how budgets are impacting on climate positively or negatively or otherwise. Can I ask kind of what the next phase of work is with that? How does that proceed into the next session of parliament so that we always have a transparent budget? We always know what the climate implications are, even if some economic trade-offs have to be made by governments.
Perhaps I'll start off and Kate can maybe pick up after that. The Joint Budget Review Working Group met last year. Officials are currently working very hard on an agreed work plan so that the improvements can be delivered for the 22-23 budget and built on after that. And in the very immediate term, just to reassure Mark Ruskell that work is actually happening, we are in the process of commissioning supporting research that we hope is going to allow the Joint Budget Review to provide initial insights during the course of this Parliament. Now, I'm conscious that the course of this Parliament doesn't have very long to run, so I'm not sure whether or not Kate Forbes would have anything to add to that. But we have considered proposals from colleagues to make improvements to this year's budget assessment, and therefore we've added additional information to the budget document as a result. So the intention is to continue working on the review, seeking to improve budget information on climate change, and not just in terms of the 22-23 budget, but also to be able to develop the proper tools necessary to work towards a costed climate change plan in 2024. And that's important because the next Parliament will also at the same time have to renew the entire climate change plan. So it's just to reassure the member that actually there is a lot of work that is ongoing. I don't know if Kate wants to come in on the back of that.
I think that was quite a comprehensive answer, and I support all those efforts. And as Rosanna Cunningham said, in terms of additional information that we've added to this budget, you know, we have added additional information concerning taxonomy assessments of capital spend. So there are improvements being made year on year. And I would agree with Mark Ruskell that I think the conversation has moved on quite substantially. There is some evidence of actual tangible changes being made. There's a wee way to go in terms of getting the Joint Budget Review and proposing recommendations that we then implement. But certainly from a finance perspective, I'm very supportive of working with Parliament colleagues, committee colleagues to make further improvements to the budget assessment.
Thank you. We have run out of time, and I want to thank both Cabinet Secretaries for the time this morning and for the officials who have given them support. At our next meeting, which is tomorrow, 16th of February, the committee will take evidence on the environmental implications of the EU exit from experts and stakeholders and the regulators. And we also expect to hear from the Cabinet Secretary on the single-use carrier bags charge Scotland Amendment Regulations 2021. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you.